Welcome from the Microsoft Detection and Response team. The intent of this presentation is to provide you with a high-level guidance and conceptual framework for responding to the recently disclosed vulnerabilities in Exchange Server. These vulnerabilities are currently being exploited in the wild. The guidance provided here is intended to complement and inform your incident response plan. Earlier this year, security researchers responsibly disclosed the existence of vulnerabilities in Exchange Server to Microsoft. These vulnerabilities were being exploited by a nation-state actor which Microsoft refers to as Hafnium. Exchange Server 2019, 2016, and 2013 were found to all exhibit these vulnerabilities. Exchange Server 2010 was also found to exhibit CVE 2021-26857, but only if the Unified Messaging Service is installed. Exchange Online does not have these vulnerabilities. CVE 2021-26855 is a pre-authentication server-side request forgery vulnerability, which allows an attacker to send arbitrary HTTP requests. The attacker does not require credentials into the system to exercise this vulnerability, and the vulnerability can enable accessing of email and remote code execution. The SSRF vulnerability can be combined with the other three vulnerabilities to enable arbitrary file writes. Microsoft has published updates to all the affected products to enable you to protect your organization from these vulnerabilities. In addition, Microsoft has also provided temporary mitigations which can be applied to reduce or eliminate the risk of these vulnerabilities. Once an attacker gains access to the system, they have many options, including but not limited to data exfiltration, installing additional backdoors or persistence mechanisms, such as web shells, credential theft, lateral movement, elevation of privilege, resource hijacking, for example, coin mining, a launch point to attack others, and destructive attacks, such as ransomware or system wiping. Microsoft has observed attackers creating web shells to gain persistent access to the systems for carrying out further post-exploit activities. One common technique observed when attackers are exploiting these vulnerabilities is the creation of a web shell. A web shell is a piece of malicious code often written in typical web development programming languages. Attackers implant a web shell on web servers to gain persistent remote access and code execution capabilities. Web shells can allow attackers to execute commands of their choosing and to steal data from a web server, as well as using the server as a launching pad to gain further access within a victim environment. A pair of excellent resources about web shells, the threats they pose, and how to protect your organization from web shell attacks are included in the two articles listed here. The following flowchart is recommended for responding to these vulnerabilities. If you have not patched your Exchange Server 2013, 2016, or 2019, your organization is vulnerable to attack. The vulnerabilities discussed in this presentation are under active attack. Do not wait to start mitigation. Implement a mitigation plan as soon as possible. There are multiple mitigation options available to your organization. The basic components of a response plan are mitigation, investigation, remediation, attack surface reduction and hardening, and active monitoring. Microsoft recommends a defense in depth and assume compromise approach. Do not wait to start mitigation until after you've done your investigation. You can do them both in parallel, but you need to start mitigation immediately. Once you implement a mitigation, an investigation is still required, since if the attacker has already exploited the vulnerability, you have to assume they established some persistence on the machine. Even after doing a thorough investigation or remediation, there's possibility that the attacker may still have presence. You still need to assume breach and place as many barriers to an attacker being able to go undetected in your environment as possible. Attack surface reduction, hardening, and active monitoring for any additional malicious activity. If the attacker has managed to gain access to privileged identities, there may not be any malware to detect or remove. If your organization requires you to preserve evidence as part of your incident response plan, implement your evidence preservation process. Mitigation is necessary to prevent future exploitation of these vulnerabilities. Microsoft provides a variety of methods to mitigate the threat. The most complete and effective mitigation strategy is to fully patch the most recent Exchange Server cumulative update. All other mitigation approaches are only partial mitigation approaches. These vulnerabilities are being exploited in the wild by multiple malicious actors. If you have not taken any action already, your organization's servers are vulnerable to attack. Once you have applied a mitigation, that does not remove the need to investigate and possibly remediate the server if it had been previously compromised using this or any other vulnerability. The mitigation strategies are as follows. Isolation. Blocking incoming internet traffic over port 443 will mitigate against these threats, but only for traffic coming from the internet. For traffic coming from inside your network, the vulnerabilities are still exploitable. If an attacker had already established a presence inside your network, your Exchange servers are still vulnerable to attack. Mitigation scripts. Microsoft has provided mitigation scripts for mitigating all four vulnerabilities. These scripts do mitigate the threats, however, they may limit some Exchange functionality. The Exchange on-premises mitigation tool only implements the mitigation for the SSRF vulnerability. Security updates for legacy cumulative updates. To provide organizations with more flexibility, Microsoft has provided security updates for the four vulnerabilities, which can be applied to legacy cumulative updates. These do not provide any mitigation for additional vulnerabilities, which may be present in those products. Updates for supported cumulative updates. The most complete and effective mitigation is to apply all security updates and patches to the supported cumulative update. Microsoft recommends implementing a mitigation strategy immediately and then moving to a fully up-to-date and patched cumulative update for the maximum protection as quickly as possible.
During the investigation phase, which can be done in parallel to the mitigation phase, it is critical to be thinking about whether or not your organization has an obligation to preserve forensics evidence, along with what kind of investigation you need to perform. We call out a basic investigation or advanced investigation below with some high-level steps and processes to follow. A basic investigation would simply be run the MSCRT or safety scanner, along with evaluate the console output of the test proxy logon script that can be downloaded and ran from the CSS Exchange GitHub repository. This is the most basic version of doing an investigation and can pivot into an advanced investigation based on the output from the test proxy logon script and the MSRT scanner. We recommend that you run MSERT in quick mode the first time, allowing for a faster scan of important directories and help you whether your organization should pivot to a more advanced investigation or simply stay at the basic investigation. Once you've determined the results of the test proxy logon script and the MSERT quick scan, you should pivot back and run the MSERT in full scan against all drives in the Exchange system. This can take several hours or even a day. An advanced investigation will consist of reviewing the HTTP proxy, ECP, IIS, event logs from the Exchange server, and likely looking at disk artifacts for indicators of compromise, such as web shells or malicious code, being utilized, not just dropped onto the system. These indicators can be anything from LSAS being dumped for credentials and memory, dropping of coin mining software, creating local user accounts on the Exchange systems, and other administrative tasks that typically can be performed. To help with this investigation phase, we have a high-level diagram of what the indicators of attack or indicator of compromise look like. When looking at IOAs or IOCs, you will likely see signs of scanning attributed to your internal team scanning if your organization is vulnerable, external security vendors scanning the internet, or malicious attackers trying to determine if your organization can be compromised easily using the SSFRF vulnerability. If your organization sees signs of scanning, ensure that your organization has either completed the mitigations previously mentioned or has plans to implement them as soon as possible. You will then want to look for further details such as a web shell dropped on the Exchange system and or web shells being actively used to exfiltrate data or access internal systems. This is where you will want to determine if you need to go to the remediation phase or a full incident response investigation. We have seen organizations that have had web shells dropped on their Exchange servers that were not ever utilized more than dropped for future use. This is where you will want to move to the remediation phase as soon as possible to help protect your organization from further exploits. If you see signs of lateral movement or web shell being used, this is where you need to determine or use your organization's incident response playbook to determine the next path. Next, we'll talk about the remediation steps that are high level, but at a minimum should be considered while going through your organization's response. During remediation, it is important to understand your organization's regulatory or compliance requirements, along with knowing that the information below is only a basic framework and every remediation should be tailored to your environment and organization needs. If you have an established incident response or remediation framework, you should ensure that at a minimum, you think about incorporating these steps or processes to your procedures. The first step is to ensure that you have the ability to preserve forensics evidence for the potential of having an outside incident response firm or for legal and compliance needs. CISA, CISA, has a good guidance that can be used to follow using freely available tools for how to complete this step. Once you've collected your forensics evidence, you should disconnect the Exchange server from the network, external and internal. This allows for any command and control services or malicious code that beacons outside the network to stop functioning while you work through remediation. The next step is to restart the Exchange server to remove any memory resident, non-persistent threats from running on the system. This step will not protect you from persistent threats that are designed to execute in memory upon restart, but will give you added assurances. After restarting the server, it is important to run a full antivirus scan. This includes ensuring that antivirus exclusions that are typically put in place for Exchange servers for performance reasons are not adhered to. MSCRT does not adhere to antivirus exclusions and is good for this step. A note on MSCRT is it's updated constantly, so be sure to download a new copy upon each execution to make sure your organization is running definitions for the latest threats our malware researchers are finding and responding to. After you've disconnected the system, rebooted, and run a full scan, you will want to patch not only Exchange with the latest hotfixes, but also any applications and the operating system itself. If you have plans to decommission the server, while not ideal, since this process can typically take a long time to complete, now is a perfect chance to also consider this as a remediation step. Once you have patched or decommissioned the server, you will want to make sure that credentials for elevated accounts at a minimum are rotated during the process of dropping a web shell or malicious code that could have stolen credentials that will allow an attacker in a future state to access the network via such things as a VPN or web gateways. It is important to know that even when you do a full incident response, you are never guaranteed that you have completely removed all the threats. Therefore, you still want to assume breach even after you've done all the remediations. With attack surface reduction and hardening, it is important to note that in today's threat landscape, simply having antivirus is typically not enough. Having an EDR solution that allows you to monitor processes and behaviors is critical to alerting and finding malicious activity on your network. If your organization does not currently use an EDR solution, you should investigate at a minimum to install and have this on your Tier 0 assets, such as Exchange and Identity solutions. You will want to enable real-time protection along with cloud protection for your antivirus applications within the organization. Cloud protection is important as it allows for your organization to stay up to date with more of the latest behavior and malicious code detections. Run a full scan of the system with exclusions bypassed, much like we did within the remediation phase. Ensure your organization's antivirus exclusions are as locked down as they can be. Calling attention to applying exclusions to all systems versus the systems that need the exclusions, along with excluding whole directories or drives. Investigate such things as Exchange split permission model to further reduce the attack surface of having an on-premise Exchange environment. Look at AppLocker, Application Guard, or other third-party whitelisting software to ensure that only known and approved applications or tasks are executing on the Exchange server environment. We now move on to one of the most critical portions, which is active monitoring. During this phase, you will find your organization should pay attention to the solutions that are in the environment or added to the environment. When you're looking at the solutions in your organization, make sure you have processes and policies to not just look, but action on alerts. Having a user and entity behavioral analytics, UEBA solution, allows for you to monitor identity behaviors in the organization. Ensure you're ingesting your IIS logs into a SIEM or SOAR solution, along with ensuring the real source IP address will show up if you're using a load balancing solution. Your organization should be in a constant state of monitoring, testing, and validation. If your organization blocks all ports except 443 to your Exchange server, have you validated that from the outside? If not, ensure that you're not just implementing protections, but you're verifying them and testing. On this page, you will find further links on how to implement such things as Exchange split permissions, the MSERT scanning tool, and other Microsoft recommendations previously mentioned in this video. Thank you.